and welcome to another Lighthouse Christian Church service. If this is your first time, we would just love to say hello. So please type in your name in the chat box or just say a good old-fashioned hi. It's wonderful to connect during this quarantine and during this time of separation. We don't have to really be distant during this social distancing. So today is a very special day. Today is Mother's Day, and we would just love to wish all the mothers, from one mother to another, all the mothers a happy Mother's Day. We know that you deserve it. So I just thank God for you and thank God that you are being the mother that God has called you to be. And for those who are going through a hard time today, not every person has a wonderful time during Mother's Day. If you are having a hard time and if you are brokenhearted for whatever reason, we would just love to implore you and to let you know and to encourage you in this moment to know that God is near to the brokenhearted. So if you are brokenhearted today, just reach out to Him and let Him know your heart and let Him minister to you today. But for the rest of us, I just ask that you just get into this church service and to just worship with us when it's time to worship and praise with us when it's time to praise. And we have a little surprise for you at the end, so stay tuned.
Nothing compares to this. Happy Sunday to you, Lighthouse family. By now, you're probably used to seeing us in this fashion. And if you're not used to it, it's okay, because it's still a little bit awkward not being able to be face to face. But the good thing is we get to stay connected. We get to come straight to your living room from right where we are and share in the joys of what the gospel brings. With that thought in mind, we want to invite you out once again to Bible study on Wednesday nights at 7 o'clock. Please, please, please join us in a good time of fellowship, in a good time of studying God's word, and an excellent, excellent time to love on our God through searching out the scriptures together. Go to our website, which is lighthousesj.church. Click Bible study and let's get ready to dive into God's word together. Once again, God bless you, brothers and sisters, and we'll see you on Wednesday night at 7 o'clock.
Hey, Lighthouse, it's Nalaysha, and I'm here to tell you guys about Family Fridays. As things around us are constantly changing, we want to make sure that we are still connecting and engaging as a body. So what is Family Fridays? Family Fridays is going to be a time for us to get together online and do something fun together, to talk and catch up and make sure that we're forging those relationships that are necessary as the body of Christ. There's going to be something different every week, so click on our website, lighthousesj.church, and find the Family Friday picture, and you'll be able to get everything you need to know to participate. So join us Fridays at 4. See you then.
To Christ. stars watched in vain. Was morrow for 3 days. His body there would not remain. Our God has robbed the grave.
Our God has robbed the grave.
He's robbed the grave. Always robbed the grave.
She always tells me to, no matter what, chase my dreams and go after what I want in life. I love you.
Wake up. My mom says I love you all the time.
She likes saying, I love you.
I love you.
Eating.
Food.
Being around family and things like that.
Our dogs.
Clean up.
He lets us go in the front and ride bikes.
When my little brother and sister goof around.
Me.
She loves to go to the beach or to spend time with her dog, Stella.
Playing with us.
She likes hugging me. And giving me a kiss.
For her, taking us places, even though she doesn't want to. I'm proud of her because it seems that no matter what, she's always over any obstacles in life.
She cooks for me.
Just how hard she works. I could really appreciate the amount of effort and care it took to raise 3 naughty children, like me and my siblings, and that. Thank you, Mom, for that.
That she is my mom.
Because they're my mommy, daddy, dog.
She expresses it and says it a lot.
She just loves me.
She gives us kisses.
She shows it in a doable way.
Because she tries her hardest each and every day to make sure our family is happy.
A hug.
A brand new phone. Love you, Mom.
A house.
I would give her everything that she's given me. I would give her home. I would
make it to where she wouldn't have to buy her own food, but I would make it to where I'm taking care of her. If she would want anything, I would love to get it to her as soon as possible.
Today for Mother's Day, I don't want to give you 10 more things to do because your lives are already busy. Today instead, we're going to talk together about what moms need and how you can help. For moms, I hope and pray there's some encouragement here. You need to be encouraged. And for all of us, every one of us, there are some things you can do to help mom. Whether you have a mom or you're close to a mom, we all know a mom. And there are some things we can all do to help moms. Let me say this. This is one sermon you're going to want to share with your kids. We're going to talk about helping mom today. So if your kids aren't here right now, I want you to get the link for this sermon, put it by their little bed, and play it every night so they can hear it again and again. A couple of things to do with this message. First of all, if you're a parent, I would encourage you to take notes and pass this along to your kids. It'll have a lot more impact coming from you than them hearing it from me. Even if they are listening right now, take some notes and share it with your kids. For all of us, decide to do something about it. Everyone can do something to help moms. Everyone knows a mom, so we can all do something to help moms. The Bible tells us to honor mothers, to honor our parents. Ephesians, quoting from the Ten Commandments in the Old Testament, says this: honor your father and mother. God put it into the Ten Commandments, this command to honor your father and mother. God would not have put that into the Ten Commandments just as a nice sentiment, like, that'll look good on a card someday, or I think I'll put it in the Ten Commandments. No, God didn't have to put it in there. God's eternal. He was never born. He didn't have to put it in there to please his mom. That's not why it's in the Ten Commandments. It is there because God knows it's vital for our spiritual health, for our emotional health, to honor our parents. So, how can you honor your mother? Even if they're no longer alive, you can still honor your mother. Even if you didn't know your mom or you had a terrible mom, you can still honor the fact that she labored to bring you into this world. We can all honor moms by seeing the importance of what they're doing and helping them out in what they're doing. We're going to focus in on some of that today. There was a survey taken a couple of years ago. I believe it's still relevant. It asked moms to be honest with some of the frustrations that they face and some of the things that they need. A lot of what I'm going to talk about today is based on what they said, just responding back to what they said. I want to talk together about the top 8 things that that survey showed that moms need and the things you and I can do to help. In this, we're going to talk about how you can be encouraged as a mom and how all this can help moms. The number one thing that was in that survey, the number one thing that moms said, this is something I need, this is a point of frustration in my life, Moms need patience. In the survey, as they talked about their needs, moms said, "I need to have enough patience with my kids." That was again and again and again. One mom said, "I need to find the peace of Christ when they are crying, fussing, demanding children, making my house noisy." Some of you can relate to that. Someone said, "Teaching patience and acceptance to my daughters. They're both married and I feel challenged to help them to realize the treasure that life is." Teaching patience, the whole spectrum of being a mom. Four quick things about patience based on the next four verses. When you think about needing patience as a mom, when any of us think about needing patience, remember, God understands. You are not alone, moms. This next verse is about how God was treated by the people in the Old Testament. See if you think God might be able to relate to how you feel sometimes. Psalm 78, verse 56 says, "Though he did all of this for them, they continued to test his patience." Ever feel like that as a mom? If you feel like my patience is being tested, when will this stop? God understands. Why is it, by the way, that our patience is tested by other people? None of us are perfect. You take imperfect people and you put them near each other, we're going to test each other's patience. We're going to irritate each other. That's true in a job when you get put close together. That's true in school, and it's especially true in a family. It's inevitable that our patience is going to be tested. And when it is, God says, "I understand." The second thing about patience to remember is patience is an expression of love. A lot of the surveys, when I read them, seemed to say that the fact that I'm feeling impatient means I don't love kids, when the exact opposite is true. You have a choice to love your kids, even when you're feeling impatient. When you're patient, although you feel impatient, that's an incredible expression of love. Ephesians 4:2 says, "Be patient with each other, making allowance for each other's faults because of your love." If you think you're only loving when you feel patient all the time, no. Love is choosing to be patient even when you're irritated. Love is making allowance for someone else's faults. Patience is an expression of love. The third thing about patience in the next verse is patience is used by God. Patience is used in our lives to grow us by God. James chapter 1, verses 3 and 4 says, "When the way is rough, your patience has a chance to grow. So let it grow. Don't try to squirm out of your problems. But when your patience is finally in full bloom, then you will be ready for anything strong in character and full and complete." Patience grows us. Any kind of patience. Not just the opportunity to, but the decision to be patient in a difficult circumstance. That grows us. Here's why this is especially significant for parents, for moms. Why patience has such an opportunity to grow you. If I'm in a job and I have to be patient in that job, but I don't want to be patient, I can bail out. I can just leave. I can just quit. Even though God might want me to stay there and learn by being patient, I can bail out. If I have a friend and God wants me to be patient in that relationship, to learn and to grow, I can get out of that friendship. I can leave. But when it comes to your kids, you're stuck with your kids. You can't bail out. You are forced to be patient And in that decision to be patient, God says he grows you. God grows us through our patience. One of the reasons I think moms are some of the most spiritually mature people on the planet is because they've had to be so patient with us. That patience, the Bible says, enables us to be ready for anything, strong in character, full and complete. Just in case a couple of you kids are listening right now and thinking, this is great. The more irritating I am to my mom, the more she has to be patient and the more she grows spiritually. I'm a source of spiritual growth in her life like no one else. This is awesome. If you are thinking that way right now, I have a fourth thing to say about patience. God tells us to help each other. When you see someone struggling with patience and stress, the Bible says, help each other. What can you do for your mom, for your wife, when her patience is being overly stressed? Jesus said this in Matthew chapter 7, verse 12. Do for others what you would like them to do for you. Some of you recognize that as the golden rule. It's a picture of the true nature of love. True love is not reciprocal. I do this for you because you do this for me. True love is sacrificial. I do this for you regardless of what you do for me. Jesus said, I can give you that kind of love. No one else can, but I can give you that kind of love. When you see mom stressed, when you see a mom stressed, instead of piling on or running away, you do something to help relieve that stress. That's what you'd want done for you. The golden rule applies to moms too, because moms need patience. There's a second thing moms need. Moms need appreciation. We all do, and the Bible recognizes that often. In the Bible, you see people being appreciated because we have a need for this. Paul said this in Philippians chapter 1, verse 3. I thank my God every time I remember you. And in Colossians 1, verse 3, whenever we pray for you, we always begin by giving thanks to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. It's good to be appreciative of other people. You can appreciate your mom no matter what. You say, what if my mom died? You can still appreciate her. You can still think back and remember the tenacity that she had to get things done that she really wanted to get done. You can still look back and remember the positive spirit that she had even in the difficult times. You can still appreciate that today. What if you didn't know your mom, or you had a very difficult relationship with your mom? Appreciate the fact that she labored to bring you into this world. Appreciate the fact that you weren't aborted. Appreciate the fact that you are alive. Why is that important? Because the Bible says, honor your father and your mother. Even the smallest amount of honor that you can give is healthy for your soul. Moms need appreciation. With most moms, the truth of the matter is there are hundreds, there are thousands of things to appreciate. If your mom is here, take every opportunity you can. Don't miss a chance to appreciate her. Say it. Say it with words. Say it with flowers. Say it with candy. Say it with cards. Say it with stocks and bonds. Say it however you want to say it, but say it. In fact, we're going to take a few moments right now to recognize moms. A few minutes to appreciate moms. We want to say we appreciate you. Now, when it comes to appreciation, it is a good thing to say thank you. It's even a better thing to say, I thank God for you. That's what Paul expressed in these couple of verses we read a moment ago. I thank God for you. Sometimes you need to say to mom just thank you. But sometimes it's good to say, I want you to know I thank God for you. I'd like to take a moment to do that right now. God, we thank you for moms. Thank you for their importance, the difference they make in this world, the incredible impact they have. What moms do is so important. There are so many emotions that swirl around. For some of us, this is a difficult day. We miss the mom that has died, or we're grieving because we're not yet a mom, or because we have a relationship with a mom where we struggled. It's just an example of how important this day is. God, for those who are going through that today, I pray that you would comfort them right now. God, for all the moms that are here, for all the moms that are in our minds right now, that we so deeply appreciate, we want to say thank you. Thank you for the literally millions of things they do that make an incredible difference here and all the way into eternity. Thank you for their faith, their heart for you. Thank you for the willingness to sacrifice and to share their lives so that others' lives might be encouraged and improved and changed and challenged and filled with faith. We thank you, Jesus, for moms. In your name, amen. Moms need appreciation. There's a third thing that moms need. Moms need a life. As moms talked about this, they talked about time management. The Bible says in Psalm 127, verse 2, it is useless for you to work so hard from early morning until late at night, anxiously working for food to eat, for God gives rest to his loved ones. That's an example of a life without balance. You read that, work so hard from early morning to late at night, and you think that that's the job description of most moms. Does this verse have anything to do with families? Does it have anything to do with moms? During this study, I was reminded of the verse that comes right after that verse. And in verse 3, it says, children are a gift from the Lord. This verse is all about parenting. It's all about what it means to be in a family. It's a reminder of the fact that you need a life even as a parent. Moms need a life. And the life they need is the life that Jesus wants to give. He wants to give it. In John chapter 10, verse 10, it says this. Jesus said, I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. We've got to help moms enjoy the abundant life that Jesus has given. If I'm so rushed and so hurried and my life is so filled that I don't have time to connect with Jesus and enjoy the abundant life, what am I modeling for my kids? We've got to give moms the time to enjoy this abundant life. It's interesting. In this survey, moms shared some of their frustrations. Dads were also asked, what could you do to help your wife as a mom? What's the number one thing you think you could do to help out? Just about at the top of that list was spend more time with my kids. Think about this for a moment. Moms know intuitively, I need a break every once in a while from the kids. And dads know intuitively, I need to spend more time with my kids. It seems like there's a pretty simple answer there, isn't there? Why don't we get this? What keeps us from getting it? We don't get there sometimes, we all know that. What keeps us from getting this? You get into patterns and it's hard to break those. Others can help. We can make a difference in each other's lives. We all need the abundant life that Jesus came to offer. In order to enjoy that, we've got to watch out for each other sometimes. Help each other out. Moms need a life. Moms need wisdom. Especially, they talked about with all the negative influence in our culture, moms need wisdom. They need wisdom to know when to hold on and when to let go. They need wisdom to know when to say yes and when to say no. They need wisdom when it comes to discipline, to know when and how. Moms need wisdom. God says he will give wisdom in James chapter 1, verse 5. If any of you need wisdom, you should ask God for it. He is generous and he enjoys giving wisdom to all people. He will give you wisdom. You might have prayed from time to time for wisdom in your life. Have you ever prayed for wisdom for someone else? Ever prayed for wisdom for a mom? Husbands, have you ever prayed for wisdom for your wife as a mom? Pray for wisdom. That's one of the things we can do. Now, one of the greatest things you can do for moms is pray for moms. We always think about moms praying for us. We need to pray for moms. We need to pray for moms' wisdom. It's an incredibly, wonderfully powerful thing to pray for. In fact, instead of waiting for some other time to do it, I encourage you right now, in the back of your mind, pray for a mom. Pray for your mom, some mom that you know. Do that right now. In the back of your mind, pray for a mom. In Colossians chapter 2, verse 3, God has hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge in Christ. We need wisdom because it's not easy raising kids. It comes with not just headaches, it comes with heartaches in this world. When it comes to raising kids, we face difficulty. We face daily struggle, but we also face tragedy. We need wisdom. We need God's wisdom. I can't figure it out with my human intellect. I need something above that. I need something beyond that. I'm not willing to just give up and say this world is a crazy place and I can't figure it out. Instead, I want to hang on to God's wisdom. In this world, often life is fragile. We don't like to face that. We don't like to admit that, but it's true. Life is fragile in this world. What do I do about that? I recognize that in God's wisdom, he's heading us towards an eternity where life is not fragile. It is eternal. It is in God's hands, and no one can take me out of his hands. It is with him forever. It is a promise that he will never deny, and I look forward to that. That's why the Bible says, as believers, we grieve when tragic things happen, and we should, but we don't grieve as those who have no hope. We have hope for things, for the future. When I can't figure it out myself, and there are things in life that I cannot figure out on my own human power, I need God's wisdom. I need it to remind me that there is something greater that I can hang on to. Moms need wisdom. Moms need validation. That's my word, not theirs. They need validation. But by that I mean they need recognition of the importance of what they are doing. Proverbs 31 is the most famous chapter in the Bible about being a mom and being a wife. Here's how that chapter ends. Her children arise and call her blessed. Her husband also, and he praises her. Many women do noble things, but you surpass them all. Charm is deceptive, and beauty is fleeting. But a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Give her the reward she has earned, and let her works bring her praise in the city gate. This is a chapter, Proverbs 31, all about validating the importance of what moms do. Now look at the last two words in that passage. The last two words are city gate. Why are those words important? Because that was the place of importance when this verse was written. In ancient times, the city gate was not just the doorway into the city. It was where everything important happened. All the legal cases were tried there. All the government decisions were made there. All the business deals happened there. It was the place of importance. When this says, "Let her works praise her in the city gate," it's saying at the place of most importance. For us, it would be City Hall, the floor of Congress, or what have you. This is reminding us, don't let the importance of moms and what they do, parents and what they do, be some sort of side issue you give a salute to and then go on to what really is important. This is what is important. At the place of most importance, at the seat of power, recognize the value of what moms do, what parents do. Mom, you are building a person. The Bible tells us that only people are going to last forever. Buildings don't last forever. As beautiful as they might be, as inspiring as they might be, a building is not going to last into eternity. Companies don't last forever. As well run or as profitable as it might be, a company is not going to last forever. Your bank account, the way it's set up, certainly won't last forever. Even governments, as powerful as they are not going to last forever. But people last forever. That is the importance of what you do. Moms, you are building a person. On this Mother's Day, I just want to say to my wife, Nessie, what you do is so important. All moms, we want to say to you, what you do is so important. When Satan puts a little thought in the back of your mind and says, it's just a little thing, not very meaningful what you do, that is a lie. When someone says something to you, some snide remark that makes you feel unimportant for what you do, partly because of their insecurity is why they say it, recognize that that is a lie. People last forever. What you do is so important. Moms need validation. Moms need communication. They need talk. They need listening. One mom said, I need communication. I need to hear, especially from teenagers. Another mom said, I need to get my children's attention and have them listen and hear. Both sides, they need communication. Sometimes talk, sometimes listening. That's something we can do for moms. For those of you who might be here, teenagers or maybe dads, we remind ourselves of this. We need to remind ourselves that a complete conversation is not comprised in the word fine. That is not a complete conversation. How was everything at work today? Fine. That's not the whole conversation. How was everything at school today? How did it go today? Fine. And you're up to your room. No, just a little bit more is needed to make a huge difference. So, how do you talk to your mom? The same way the Bible says to talk to everyone else. Ephesians 4, verse 29 reads, "Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths." I don't know why it is, but people who are close to us, sometimes we say ugly things, unhealthy things, things we wish we had never said. The Bible says, be careful because that's easy to do. Don't choose to let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouth. It goes on to say, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. talk to mom in a way that benefits those who listen. I think this is especially significant for those who struggle with moms who are getting older, and maybe who are going through physical struggles where it's just not mom anymore. It's frustrating even to try to communicate. You find yourself angry and saying frustrating words you wish you hadn't said. This is a good verse to remind yourselves, God, give me the strength to not say the wrong thing. God, give me the strength to do the thing that builds up. Sometimes you have to get a break and then come back. Moms need communication. Moms need rest. It's interesting, in the survey, it was evident that moms are dealing with the twin emotions of exhaustion and guilt. Exhaustion because they were doing too much, and guilt because they felt like they weren't doing enough. That is a difficult trap to be in. A lot of moms are there. That trap shows me that they do need physical rest, but they also need soul rest. The kind of rest that Jesus talked about in Matthew 11, verse 28. Jesus says, "Come to me, all of you who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest." I will give you rest. You give mom time to spend time with Jesus. That's vital. There's a soul rest that you must have in order to be a parent. If you're not familiar with the story of Susanna Wesley from Christian history, it's a good story to be aware of. Susanna Wesley, two of her sons were Charles Wesley and John Wesley, founders of the Methodist movement. They changed Europe and then they changed America. They were greatly used of God. They grew up with 10 kids in the household. Their mom knew she needed time to be alone with Jesus Christ. And she found that time sometimes by finding a room where she could be alone. But with 10 kids, that was impossible a lot of the time. So instead, what she would do much of the time is she would take her apron and put it up over her head. And the kids would know that meant mom was now spending time with Jesus. All the kids knew that if you interrupted mom when she was spending time with Jesus, you would go to see Jesus. They knew that was not a good thing to do. That's just a creative way to find some space. Help moms to do that. We've got to help moms. We've got to help each other out in everything. Moms need rest. There's an eighth thing that moms need. It came out again and again in the survey, and it showed the quality of the moms that took the survey. Moms need faith. One mom talked about lack of faith that God is in control and worrying needlessly. Another mom talked about feeling the weight that daily decisions affect my kids for the rest of their lives. I need faith so I don't worry about this. Moms need faith. And Jesus offers faith. John chapter 14, verse 1, Jesus says, "Don't be troubled. You trust in God. Now trust in me." Jesus says, when you recognize that you need faith, don't try to conjure it up through your own emotional energy. Lean on me. That's what faith is. It is a leaning on me. You trust in God, now trust in me. When it feels like there is nowhere else to turn, Jesus says, turn to me. You can trust in me. That's where you find faith. Psalm 62, verse 8, "Trust in him at all times. Pour out your heart to him, for God is our refuge." Moms need faith for the big things, the most difficult things in life. Moms also need faith, it came up again and again, for the everyday things. Faith in the day-to-day. Faith when you're tempted to worry. Sometimes moms are tempted to worry. In fact, if you look up mom in the dictionary, one of the definitions is she who is tempted to worry for the entire rest of the family. That's sort of the job of a mom. What do you do when you're tempted to worry? We all are. Do you get upset with yourself? Angry? Why am I doing this again? Every time you're tempted to worry, recognize that it's also an invitation to have faith. Here's the difference between worry and faith. With worry, when you worry, it feels like you're doing something, but in the end, nothing gets done. But when you put faith in God, many times at the beginning, it doesn't feel like you're doing much, but everything changes because you're putting faith in a God who can do everything. When you're worried, you're just focusing on yourself. And you become more and more anxious, and you do less and less. But when you put faith in God, that changes everything. The Bible tells us in the book of Philippians, don't be anxious for anything, but in everything, by prayer, supplication with thanksgiving, let your request be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all comprehension, it will guard your hearts. It will guard your minds in Jesus Christ. That is the value of faith in everyday life. Moms need faith. Moms need patience. They need appreciation. Moms need a life. Moms need wisdom and validation and communication. Moms need rest. Moms need faith. Let me sum all this up in one word. One word. What does your mom need from you? This may sound like a strange word at the beginning, but let me tell you, then explain it. Your mother needs you to repent. That's what your mother needs from you. Some of you are thinking, that brought back memories. Wow. Well, what does that mean? For a lot of us, the word repent has become an angry word. Some people use it that way. That's extremely unfortunate because the word repent is one of the most beautiful words, positive words in the Bible. In the English language, you know what repent means? It just means turn around. It means head in a different direction. It means God gives you a second chance. It means God gives you the opportunity for a new life. It means things can be different. So you repent. You change your heart and mind. You realize that it's not just the job of moms to meet our needs. It's also our job to meet their needs. We're in this together. That may be something as small as saying thank you for a meal when you haven't done it for a long time. Or it might be something as radical as giving your life and faith to Jesus Christ because of a mom who never stopped praying for you. Lord, thank you. Thank you for moms. They bring us into this world. They grow this world. They send us out into the world, and they prepare us for the next world. Thank you for moms. Give us the grace to be grateful. Give us the strength to encourage one another, to put our faith, our hope, our trust in you. You are trustworthy. Thank you, Jesus. In your name, amen.
Okay, so now we are coming to another form of our praise and another form of our worship, and that is through giving. God says that He loves a cheerful giver. And so please make sure as you give to be cheerful, because He can see the heart and He can see our genuine desire to bless Him as He's blessed us. So now this is a time for giving. If you are wondering, how do you give during this time? There's a couple ways you can do it. First, go onto our website, lighthousesj.church. And click on the button that says give, and you'd be able to see how to give there, walk through the prompts. Another way to give is through your cell phone. Text the number, everybody's texting now, text the number 84321. Again, that's 84321. And text the number you'd like to give, and they'll walk you through it. Okay, moms, we have a surprise, as I promised. Today is Mother's Day, and we did not leave you hanging, so we have a gift to give to you. So you come on down right now. Okay, maybe not now, But by 1 o'clock today, 295 West Main Street, we have a gift for you. Now, these are great gifts. I saw them. I saw some of them. I got a sneak peek, and they didn't let me take any. So I have to go down just like you, but I will be there because these are some great gifts. So please come on down today by 1 o'clock so we can give you your gift because you deserve it. You deserve it. All right. We will be practicing our precautions. We'll have our masks on and they'll be gloved and they'll have their social distancing, but we want to bless you because you've been so great. So please come on down today by 1 o'clock. I would love to see you there. Okay, so that concludes our church service, and it was a blessing. I know it was, and I hope that it blessed you like it blessed me. All you moms out there and all you dads out there who want to treat their moms right, I hope you take that message to heart. Okay, so since this is the conclusion of our service, that doesn't mean that we don't have to speak anymore. I would love to connect with you and to see you throughout the week during our social media pages, or even give somebody a call that you may not have heard for a while, and just to say hello. And don't forget to say Happy Mother's Day to all those mothers out there. God bless you, and I hope to see you soon.
Make it, 'cause if he did it before.